This morning we're going to be looking at really one verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, but I'd like to read a few verses just to get the context. And I think that as I read this, we can all resonate. We know that what Paul says is true. We've experienced it. We've experienced it not only in our lives, but also as we've attempted to share the gospel. We know this is true, but we don't want this to discourage us. We want to remember that God is able to save people through this message. As a matter of fact, he has chosen to do it this way so that he might be glorified. Let me go ahead and read for you the text, 1 Corinthians 1, verses 18 through 25. Paul writes, "For the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, 'I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the cleverness of the clever I will set aside.' Where is the wise man? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not come to know God, God was well pleased through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For indeed, Jews ask for signs, and Greeks search for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to Jews a stumbling block, and to Gentiles foolishness. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men." May the Lord bless his word to our hearing this morning. Seems like just about everything's going awry. This tablet just gave me a warning message and then pooped out, but now it's back up, so we'll see what happens. Alrighty, well, let's begin with this. The work of the gospel, the work of evangelism, is really something that the Lord has entrusted to us, but let's remember that it is the greatest possible blessing. It's a great blessing to us, not only that he has given us his gospel, because remember, without his gospel, we never would have been saved. We never would have been rescued. We never would have become part of his family. It's a great honor to have the gospel. But it's also a privilege that he has given to us to take this message and to share it with other people, to be his messengers, to be his ambassadors, those that are heralding the peace that God offers to all men. Remember what Jesus said to his church in Mark 16, verse 15. "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." That is our charge. That is our responsibility. But that is also our privilege. Now, what that means is this, that we not only have the information that we need to save those that we care about, to save our family members and our friends and our neighbors, from what they would otherwise be facing. And let's not forget what it is they're looking forward to, and that is a Christless eternity. We also have a commission that the Lord has given to us, a commission that includes not only the authority to herald this message, but also the power to do it. We have the message, we have the commission, we have the power. We have the means, in other words, to save those who are lost, save those that we care about. Now, if we are to step back for a moment and ask ourselves the question, why is it that more people, more of the people that we care about, don't come to Jesus, at least humanly speaking? Two reasons come to mind. Now, the first is one we'll just look at, and we're not going to dwell on it. We're going to look really at the second one, but the first one is also very important. The first one is because, as we step back and look, we have to say the church really isn't sharing the message as much as it can share it. Now, as I was thinking about this, I was reminded of an illustration, a painting that I saw years ago that I thought was a very striking illustration of this. It was basically a painting of this this rock that was sticking out of the ocean that had this platform that was built on it. And all around it, the sea is raging. But on the platform, there are people. And in the ocean, there are also people. The people on the platform are those who have been rescued from the ocean. And obviously there were still many people in the ocean that needed to be rescued. But the problem is that on this platform, people were doing a variety of things. Some of them were just kind of chatting with one another. Others were sitting down to a meal and enjoying the food. One guy was listening to a boombox. Somebody else was fishing, you know, off the pier, and another person was lifting weights, and all this activity was going on the platform, again, while all these people were in the ocean. But there were only a couple of people out of all those people who had been rescued and who were safe, who were actually, one of them was casting out a lifesaver to try to reclaim another person. Another one was reaching down to try to grab a hand, while most of the people on the platform were basically doing other things. Now really, what inspired this particular picture was something that William Booth was the Methodist preacher who founded the Salvation Army. It's something that he saw in the church of his day, an apparent lack of concern over the many people around them that were in danger of dying without the Lord Jesus Christ. And you know, the thing is that the painting was actually painted, you know, maybe a few decades ago, but more in our time frame, and things had not really changed by that time, and things haven't really changed that much today either. There aren't really that many that are doing what they can to reach out to others, and I think we have to admit that unless more of the Lord's people, unless we are willing to share this message, the net result is there aren't going to be many people who are rescued. You see, we're on that platform. Those are the people who have been saved from the wrath of God. There's still many people in the ocean that need to be rescued, but if we're not reaching out to them, they're not going to be rescued. Paul writes this in Romans 10, verses 13 through 15. He says, "Whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? How will they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things." The bottom line is, how are they going to believe unless they know what it is they are to believe? If those, if the people we care about are to be saved, they need to hear the gospel, which means we must be willing to share the gospel with them. That is what Jesus calls us to do. He said to his disciples before he sent them out to preach and teach in the cities around Palestine, he said, "Freely you received, freely give." There was a song we used to sing back in Calvary Chapel days. It was actually a very nice song. It reminded us of this very thing. We have freely received of God's grace, which is what Jesus was saying to his disciples. You have freely received from the Father. You've been saved. His grace has been effective to you. Your sins are forgiven. You are on your way to heaven. I want you to go out and give freely. Don't charge for this gospel. Just give it away freely. Now we are those, of course, who have freely received his grace. The Lord tells us that we are freely to offer that grace to others. Now that's one of the reasons why more people aren't coming to Jesus. The second reason really has to do with the response of the audience and how we respond to that is perhaps one of the reasons why we're more reluctant to share this gospel than we ought to be. Second reason is that the message that we're sharing doesn't appear to be believable. Those who are in the water, who are in danger of drowning in God's judgment, and again, it's for their sins, don't seem to think that they're really in any danger at all. And so they're not willing to reach out and take hold of the few hands that are reaching out to save them. And this is really what Paul is addressing in our passage this morning in verse 18 of 1 Corinthians 1. He writes, "For the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." And again, Paul had many occasions to observe this firsthand. We just read one of them in the book of Acts, but I do want you to notice it did not stop him, did it, from sharing the gospel with others, because he knew it was the only way they can be saved. So first of all, he says the word of the cross is foolishness to the unbeliever. The word of the cross, of course, is the gospel, the message that God uses to save. The message, of course, includes several things. Certainly that God exists, that God is holy and just, that everyone has sinned and is under the just sentence of death. That's one thing particularly people don't like to hear. But it is true, and they need to know their danger. But of course, we think of the gospel as good news, and the good news is that even though that is true, God so loved the world, mankind, that he was willing to send his only Son to live, to suffer, to die, and to rise again from the dead so that everyone who trusts him would be saved. Now again, stepping back for a moment, as far as the unbeliever is concerned, and we're talking about people, of course, that do not believe the Bible, do not believe God exists and so forth, anybody who believes that is either ignorant or stupid. The word Paul uses for the word foolishness here is moria, from which the word moros is derived, from which we get the English word moron, okay, moron. That's typically what people think. I mean, have you ever run into somebody who might have thought that was true of you when you shared the gospel with them? Now, they might not have said it, or maybe they did say it. Maybe they said something worse. That happens too. But certainly, many have thought that. And the same thing was true in Paul's day. This isn't unique to our generation. When he preached the gospel to the philosophers at Mars Hill in Athens, Luke records, as we read the conclusion of his sermon in Acts 17, verse 32, "Now when they heard the resurrection of the dead, some began to sneer, and others said, 'We shall hear you again concerning this. Why don't you just move along? We've had enough.'" Now, the thing is that even though most of them did not believe, there were still some who actually did believe. And that's why Paul did it. But the point I want you to see here is this, that the majority of the people thought the resurrection was foolishness. And they thought that Paul was a fool for believing it and a fool for devoting his life to sharing that message. Now, what's really changed today? You know, not really a whole lot. Unbelief is still prevalent among us. Most people are unbelievers. Most people do not believe the Bible is God's word. At best, they think that this book that we see as a treasure, they consider it to be basically the figment of deluded people's imaginations. At best, They see it as perhaps a collection of myths that were meant to teach moral lessons, kind of like Aesop's fables. Unbelief is why so many choose to put their faith in science when it comes to the theories or the questions of origins. Scientists will tell us how everything came about, why they choose to believe that Charles Darwin had it right or that Richard Dawkins is correct, rather than believing what God's word actually says. It's why they do not believe that God exists. And since he doesn't exist, why they don't have to be afraid of judgment. No God, no judgment. Now it's ironic, really, because the very reason that God is judging them is because the evidence for his existence is so clear. Listen to what Paul writes in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 20. He says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness." You have to have the truth to suppress it. "Because that which is known about God is evident within them. For God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that they are without excuse." Now their unbelievers are arguing God doesn't exist. Richard Dawkins would say, the best thing that can happen to this world is for everybody to give up religion because it's done nothing but create problems. So I'm trying to free you from religion. There's even a group today that's called the Freedom From Religion Group, and they're constantly working to try to get people, you know, get religion out of anything that has to do with the state. They don't believe God exists, or at least that's what they say, and that's what they want you to think that they believe. But the very reason that God sends his judgment into the world is because they do believe it, but they are suppressing that truth. They're trying to hide it. They're trying to cover it up. So they don't reject God, even his gospel, because there isn't enough proof. The evidence is actually overwhelming. It's not because they don't see the evidence or can't see it. As a matter of fact, God has made it evident to them. They know God exists. The reason why there are unbelievers is not because of essentially unbelief. It's because of sin. It's because their hearts are hard. It's because they don't want to believe. They have to deny God in order to live the way they want to live and not be bothered by their consciences. You know what that means. You know, you want to do something, but you know it doesn't feel right to do it because you know it's wrong, and you know that you're going to be held accountable for it, but you still want to do it. So you either have to give that up, or you have to do something about that voice inside of you that is telling you it's wrong. Well, they decide to do that latter and put that voice out. But it's because that is what they're doing, it's because that is the way that they are, that we very often hold back and do not share the gospel with them, because we do not want to deal with the implications or the complications that that brings, which is abuse. We don't like abuse. We don't like to be thought poor of. We don't like to be thought fools. We don't like to have people get angry at us and feel uncomfortable. Now, again, we all understand that. It's understandable. We know that that's one of the problems that exists here, but we do have to remember that that is not what Jesus wants us to do. He wants us to share the gospel. Now, whenever we're tempted not to tell them because that's the way they think and because of how they're going to react, there are two things that we need to remember. And the first is this: which one of us can actually say that we have never been in their position, that we didn't think the way they were thinking, maybe didn't say the things that they were saying? We were once the same as they are. We also, at one time, hated God, but the Lord had mercy on us. We were blind like them. We tried to hide the evidence of God's existence that we saw from ourselves, and we tried to convince other people too that it wasn't real, so that we would feel better about what we believed and what we were saying. But the Lord opened our eyes, and now we don't hide that evidence anymore. Now we welcome that evidence, and now we try to point it out to other people. We used to think the gospel was foolish. We used to think people who tried to share it with us were ignorant or stupid people, but now we see that it is the wisdom of God. We used to have guilty consciences like they have, but now we know what it is to be forgiven. We used to be afraid of death because we knew on the other side of death was hell for us. But now we look forward to it because there isn't hell on the other side of death. There's heaven. Death for us is really only a door that God opens to welcome us into heaven. By the way, death is the one thing we fear most of all, but the Lord has taken the sting out of death. As Richard Baxter said on one occasion, nobody really looks forward to death, not even Christians, because death is not going to be an easy thing to go through, but what's on the other side of it is glorious, and every Christian desires it. That's what the Lord has done for us. Now, we know by experience that what Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 1:18 is true. The word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. We know that because we've experienced it. God has saved us through his Son. Well, the point is basically this, and the second point. What God has done for us, he can and he will do for others, even for those we care about, for as many as he wills. Paul writes in Romans 1:16, which was our meditation, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." To the Jew who thinks the gospel is a stumbling block, to the Greek who thinks it's foolishness, it is the power of God. Why was Paul willing to do what he did? Why was he willing to be thought poorly of? Why was he willing to be abused and mistreated? Remember, if we had time, we could look at the catalog of things that Paul had to endure in 2 Corinthians. There's a long list of how many times he was beaten, stoned, shipwrecked in the wilderness without necessary things, without covering, food when hungry, and so forth. Why did he go through all of that? For this foolishness, at least in the eyes of the world, it's not really foolishness. He was willing to do it because he knew this is the only way that the Jews whom he cared about and the Gentiles that he had thought were basically accursed his entire life, this is the only way they could be saved, and he didn't want them to die and go into hell. He wanted to try to redeem them, and so he was willing to suffer for it. Peter preached at Pentecost in Acts 2:21, "And it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." I believe he was quoting the same passage Paul began what we had read earlier in Romans chapter 10. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Why was it that Paul was willing to tell people the gospel? Because everybody who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So as Paul reminded us at the very beginning, if anyone is to be saved, they have to hear the gospel. He says, again, in Romans 10, verses 14 and 15, "How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? And how will they preach unless they are sent?" They have to hear the message. Now, our Lord Jesus tells us the second greatest commandment is to love our neighbor as ourselves. The first greatest commandment is to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. But everybody else, love them as ourselves. And really, there's nobody we love more than, well, we should love the Lord most of all, but after him, we love ourselves quite a bit. That's one of the reasons why we don't share the gospel, is because we don't want to be abused. And the reason is because we love ourselves too much. We don't want to suffer abuse. But Jesus says, we are to love our neighbor as much as we love ourselves. Now, if we are to love them, then we must be willing to tell them the truth. In other words, as we think about that illustration at the beginning again of the people saved out of the ocean on the platform, we need to be those who are reaching over the side off the platform, trying to reach the people who are still in the ocean, casting the lifesaver, the life preserver, doing something to try to reach them instead of just kind of going about our business and leaving it to the other people who are willing to do it. Everybody on the platform is supposed to be reaching out to those who are drowning. We need to be willing to lay aside our comforts, to risk rejection, maybe even other forms of abuse, in order to reach them. We need to tell them that they are in danger, but we also need to tell them what Jesus has done to save all who will trust in him. Now, it is true that those that we care about might think we're foolish. They might get angry at us. They might not want to hang around with us any longer. They might try to avoid us when they see us coming. But it's also possible that they might receive the Lord Jesus Christ and be rescued from their danger. If they reject us the first time, or even the second time, or the third time, we need to keep telling them. We need not to give up. Again, I know that sometimes we look at the illustration, or not, well, not the illustration, but the account, actually, of when Jesus sent his disciples into the towns and villages in Palestine, and he said, if they don't listen to you, then as you're leaving them, you know, as you're leaving that town, dust, you know, wipe the dust off your feet and go on. It's like, if they don't hear you the first time, then just kind of move on. Now, there was a reason why Jesus told them to do that, and that's because it was a huge audience and only a few of them, and they would not be able really to get to everyone unless they kind of, you know, told the truth in one place and then moved on to a second place. The Lord doesn't intend for us to tell people once and then say, well, now they know, and so if they don't receive the Lord Jesus, then that's their problem. We need to continue to tell them, because, you know, the first exposure to anything isn't enough. We need to, well, we need basically to tell them the same things that we needed for ourselves. We needed to learn more about it. We had certain questions about it. We didn't understand everything the way we needed to understand it. And of course, we never truly understood it until the Lord, by his Holy Spirit, actually opened our eyes. But that came through a lot of sharing. It came through a lot of prayers. So we need to continue to share and not give up. Remember, if you think back on your own experience, you probably didn't receive Jesus the first time you heard about him. I know that I didn't. I was raised in a house where I heard the gospel, and it was many years before I came to the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's often the case with all of us. And yet, there was a point in which we finally did. He still saved us. So we need to share, and we need to keep sharing and keep ministering, keep loving them, encouraging them to come to Jesus, and we need to keep praying for them. And as far as we're concerned, we do need to keep our eyes open to the fact that they are in danger. We need to believe that. We need to believe that what God did for us, he can do for them too. And that he actually will do it for others. Maybe not all of them, but he will do it for some. We have to believe that there is a real possibility that at least some of these that we share the gospel with, if not all of them, sometimes the Lord does that too, will actually be standing in heaven with you because you made the effort to reach out to them and God was merciful to them. Now, again, I think one thing would be helpful for us, and I'll just say this and then we'll close. Sometimes in Calvinistic circles, you know, we think about the idea of election and so forth. If they're not chosen, it's not going to matter whether I share with them or not. But we need to remember that God's decree, God's choice, God's election is not divorced from what we do. What we do is a part of it. And if a person never hears the gospel, he's not going to be saved. If the Lord has determined that somebody is going to, if he's going to have mercy on that person, they need still to hear the gospel, and that means somebody who knows it actually has to take it to them. So his plan, his sovereignty in this whole matter, and we do believe that God is absolutely sovereign, doesn't negate responsibility. What it actually does is it confirms that what we do actually is going to be significant. If there were no plan, if there were no power exerted on the part of God, everything we would do would just be absolutely futile and would have no effect on anyone. But the fact that God actually makes his gospel, to be the means by which he saves, when he commissions us to go out and tell other people, he is intending to actually work through that gospel to save some of those people. I'd like to say all of them, but that's not what the Bible tells us. But he will save some. And the only reason why any come to him is because he works through the gospel to bring them to faith. We know that's true. We're here. We believe because of what he did in our lives. Now, Jesus is the only one who can ultimately rescue them. But if they don't hear about him, they will not believe. And the reason they won't is because they cannot believe, because they don't know what they are supposed to believe. We need to get the message out. So may the Lord give us his grace. May he give us courage. May he help us, you know, not to be so concerned about what we look like. May he help us to tell them and to keep telling them and to keep urging them and to keep praying for them until either we leave and go to heaven or they are actually converted, they're actually rescued. Now, as I told you, this evening we're going to consider two more things that will encourage us, that God will not only use the gospel to save, he will also use us to save them. As a matter of fact, the more inept we think we are, the more foolish or weak we think we are, the more likely he is to use us, which is kind of a different take on what we usually think. God wants to glorify his name, and there's no better way to do it than by working through somebody who really is small in their own sight and in the sight of others. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer, and let's ask the Lord to help us be encouraged to be those who are willing to share the gospel with more people so that they might hear and know what they need in order to be saved.